Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of that until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald the whole church, the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For us to accomplish this mystery, that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Almighty, ever-living God, we ask you to sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ, the King and exaltation, may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
May the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Lord, be with you, Lord.
When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it and will send it back here at once.' So they went off and found a colt tethered at a gate outside of the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them just as Jesus had told them to, and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him, as well as those following him, kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear brothers and sisters, this is a great day of celebration, a day that we praise God. Deacon Mervin, Deacon Bruce will assist you in getting your palms as you follow the deacons and myself in as we begin our celebration of this today's liturgy.
All right, y'all come here.
Praise,
caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross. Graciously granted that we may heed his lessons and patient suffering, and so merit a share of his blessings. We live and reign through the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God.
Thank you.
May Almighty God be with you. Well, we got a bunch of us waiting for you. Bless you.
Of him, the Lord that man might be the son of man's betrayal, will be be better for that man if he had never been born.
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, and said,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink with you in the kingdom of God."
Then, after seeing him, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have the same shape, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed. And after I have been raised up, I shall go before you together."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their face shaken, man will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place called Gethsemane, where he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch."
He advanced a little and fell to the ground, and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass by now. He said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will."
When he returned, he found him asleep. He said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray, and you may not undergo test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. And he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open, and did not know what was to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd of swords and his clothes, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with him, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him, and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. At this they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out against the rock with the swords and clubs this evening? Day after day I will put you teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, that the scriptures may be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off with them. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard, and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, allegedly,
"We heard him say, I will destroy this temple in 8 days, and within 3 days I will build another, not 8 days."
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned
the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
And then the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to the death. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was a little retort to her, one of the high priest's maidens came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too are the Nazarene, Jesus."
But he denied it, saying, "I neither know nor understand what you're talking about."
So he went out into the outer court. Then the guy closed. The maid saw him and began to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
Once again, he denied. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
"Surely you are one of them, for you swore by Elohim."
He began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And you hear a cock crow the second time. Then Peter remembered the words that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." He broke down and wept. As soon as the morning came, the chief priests and the elders and the scribes, that is, the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply, "You say so." The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned
him, "Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of?"
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the robbers who had committed murder and rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priest had handled. But the chief priest appeared at the crowd and asked him to use Barabbas for him instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Crucify him!"
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them. And after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the Praetorium, and assembled the whole court. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
And kept striking his head with a reed, spitting upon him. They knelt before him upon it. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloth, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed him to service at Passover. Simon the Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to care for his cross. They brought him to the place of the father, which is translated, place of the soul. They gave him wine, drug, and myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for him to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by. shaking their heads and saying, among themselves and said,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the cross be a miserable, and come down from the cross, that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. And noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Look, it is up in the light."
One of them ran, soaked the sponge in wine, put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down."
Jesus gave out a loud cry. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion, who stood facing him, saw him, he rubbed his legs and said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of the younger James and her Joseph, and so on. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. Summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. And he bought from a linen cloth, took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewed out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, watched where he was laid. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Greetings in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Because there is power in that name. Apostle Paul tells us it is a name above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And we come to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Today is Palm Sunday. It is a day of exuberant celebration and high praise. It is a day when words like rejoice and hosanna are used frequently. To rejoice is to show great joy and delight. Hosanna is an expression of adoration and praise. That's why today we can say glory to God. Salvation in the highest. Hosanna to the glorify God, because God is supremely praiseworthy and worthy to be praised. Today we celebrate, beginning the celebration of Holy Week. This year we hear from Mark's account the events which led to Jesus' arrest, his death. As we celebrate this Palm Sunday, it should be noted that the palm was a symbol of Roman victory. To bury the palm was to have achieved and triumphed over your enemies. For us to bear these palms is to bear not the symbol of victory, but the vanity of human foolishness, the illusion of what passes for victory in this world. The Apostle Paul says, "But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called by God, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength." These palms we have today are a sign of suffering. The suffering of Jesus and our own suffering, the suffering of his people. The word passion is a translation of the Greek word which means to suffer. And the passion is a short final period in the life of Jesus, covering his visit to Jerusalem, leading to his death by crucifixion. You might ask, why the mass is so radically turned against him? How the shout of Hosanna on Sunday transforms the shout of crucify him on Friday. Jesus did not hurt anyone. Jesus helped people. His earthly ministry took him through Judea, Samaria, Galilee, Phoenicia, the Decapolis, and Perea. As he traveled, he taught the truth, he healed the sick, and he performed miracles. His miracles were the supernatural deeds of healing, exorcisms, control over nature, and the resurrection of the dead. Nevertheless, some people accuse him of working for Satan. But his miracles and teachings were righteous. They were good. They were beneficial to humankind. He turned the water into wine at Cana. He healed the royal official's son. As Jesus went to Jairus' house to heal his daughter, amid a loud crowd, there was a woman who had an issue of blood for 12 years. Oh, she went to see many doctors to no avail. Her condition got worse, but she heard about Jesus. She came behind him in the crowd. She touched his cloak. She knew she had only touched the hem of his garment, she would be made well. When Jesus felt the power leave from him, he asked the disciples, "Who touched me?" Oh, the woman going back after him, Jesus fell at his feet, trembling and told the truth. Jesus said, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace, be healed of your suffering." Jesus goes to the Decapolis. He had met a man there who was a deputy, and he cured him. Jesus touched the man's ears, and he found that it means be open. The man was healed immediately. The people were amazed and looked at each other and said, "He has done all things well." Man, the blind called him a healer, a prophet, the one sent and an eye-opener. The man lay down healed by the pool for 38 years. He said, "Pick up your mat and walk." To the crowd ready to stone the woman caught in adultery, he said, "He who is without sin, let him cast the first stone." To the woman he said, "Go and sin no more." So why did they kill Jesus? Why did they kill such a righteous and benevolent man? Religious and political leaders of his day, they viewed him as a threat because he criticized those among them who
The political leaders were concerned because Jesus had a message of freedom and equality. Jesus threatened their base of power. Not much has changed today. The pressure from the government, the pressure from the religious leaders, it was too much. Judas betrayed Jesus for money. Peter denied ever having known him. Made a promise to God. The disciples fled when Jesus was arrested, and the crowds called for him to be crucified. Only the women stayed next to him, if it wasn't for the women. Jesus was stripped. He was nailed to the cross. He was arrested under the religious charge of blasphemy. He was arrested on a political charge, inciting a revolt against the Romans. Jesus suffered, died, and was buried. Today we reflect on the mystery of suffering. Jesus is suffering and our arms. I believe that suffering is not a problem that we can solve. Suffering is a mystery to live with. We all have to struggle to understand suffering. I believe a lot of us like to blame our suffering on God. But we know it's a part of Jesus' mission and God's plan. Jesus prayed, not my will, but your will be done. I believe one of the most important lessons we can learn from suffering is the power of prayer. Prayer comes alive as we come to God with our most devastating life experiences. In other words, we come to Him when we least feel like it. We bring our heartache, our grief, our pain. We ask these burdens be lifted from us. We come like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. We say, Lord, can you remove this cup from me? Is there another way? But ultimately, like Jesus, we must say, not my will, but your will. We must pray. Prayer comes alive when we are able to accept that which we cannot understand. Prayer comes alive when we can turn it over to God. Prayer comes alive when we say, Jesus, I know you are there for me. Sometimes it gets so hard for us. Sometimes we pray and we don't see results, even though God is already working. We might say, Lord, I pray, I pray, I pray, and nothing happens. Oh, I know that feeling, and you know it as well. But I stop by to tell you, we gotta stop looking at those Hollywood stories. When we pray, and the angel comes out of the sky and the heart, and everything is made well. God does not operate like Hollywood. God operates like God in His own time, in His own place. God provides us physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, and financially. Whatever it is, we need to let go and let God. Like you like to think he is, God is to be the one in charge of the plan. Yes. The songwriter said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress, my deliverer. God is my strength. He is the one whom I trust, my buckler, the horn of my salvation. Yes. God is where He's always been, sitting high and mighty on the throne. He's there when you need it. Suffering is a very hard thing. Let it be known Jesus is with us. We suffer in so many ways. Physical pain, emotional problems, feeling with something bad that's happening to us. A lot of us even stress our own selves out. Pain touches every human being. Suffering is a reality. I stop by here today to tell you on this Palm Sunday, Jesus is the one who has to be the ground of our being. Jesus is the one who has to be the meaning of our life. Jesus is the one who has to be our hope for today and our promise of tomorrow. Because when you understand who Jesus is, you can understand who you are. It's hard out here. We don't know what's going on in our streets. Children being gunned down. Trump seems like he wants to push a button and gun down the whole world. might seem like they're waking and we might feel like giving up. But I stop by that chair and I hold on to God's unchanging hand. Today's mass has challenged us to work through our problems. Suffering is a part of the human condition. We have to wrestle with it. We have to grapple with it. We must deal with it. It's only when you suffer, when you go through something, that you can come forth like pure gold. Jesus went through it, and he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. Jesus' passion shows us that he's the Son of God who can take pain and death and walk away from it and go and be with the Father. Holy Spirit prepares us for Jesus' coming. We understand that we must live by the glory and by the faith of God.
Yes, yes, thank you.
We're about to celebrate the Litany of the Eucharist. And the Eucharist means to give thanks. I know sometimes we look at our lives and we might go, "Lord, what kind of mess have I gotten myself into?" Actually, we want to blame and say, "God, what kind of mess have you got?" And I stop by here to tell you that life is better than what you think it is. Two of the most gracious words in any language are "thank you." Good parents teach their children as they learn to talk to say thank you when somebody does something good for them. And the children of God, we ought to thank God for all the benefits, all the good things that he has done for us. Enters gates with thanksgiving and praise. Gives thanks to him and praise his name. This week is about God's presence and your life and mine. This week is about coming to God and knowing who God is.
Yes, yes.
From the end as in the beginning, God is there. God is here. God has got the victory. There's good news today, my sisters and brothers. You are children of the King.
Yeah.
Have a blessed Palm Sunday and a powerful week.
Oh,
believe in one God, Father, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God to God, God for God, true God to God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father, through him all things is made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified and was crucified. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is Lord and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, my time and over our time. Amen.
Let us lift up our prayer and petitions to God.
Pray to the Lord.
mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
be made acceptable to God, the Almighty God.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise of the Lord of his name, for our good and the law of the Holy Church.
To the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand. So that those who are not merited by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all, who they feel already the effects of the mercy of Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Truly right and just. Our duty and our salvation always and everywhere. Thanks and thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, in Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners. Accept the unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Thank you.
to be thankful to God's word to be in the presence of the humbly pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ will be gathered to one by the Holy Spirit. The Lord, the church that thou dwell, we wish the fullness of charity together with prayer for our hope and pledge our bishops and all the clergy. Remember your servants, Bertram Holmes, Marcia Lindsay, Rich Peters, whom you call from this world to yourself. Grant that they will be granted the son of death like his, may also be one with him in the resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who died in mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all. Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed apostles and all the saints who please you throughout the ages, we may bear to the glorious eternal life. Praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and thank him, God, Almighty Father, the giver of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
gracious and grant our peace and unity and accord to your dead, who live and reign for that day.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of God's great love and peace.
Thank you.
Lord, I am not worthy of your teaching.
Jesus, Lord, forever.
these sacred gifts, and we humbly beseech you, O Lord, just as in the death of your Son, you have brought us a hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, may lead us to where you call us, in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hand of the wicked, and submitted to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever.
Amen.
We have a beautiful
church, so you can come to us with your questions, compliments, And anything else you want to say to us, okay? And you can still stop us when you see us like you always do. But we wanted you to know that there will be a dedicated time that you can come and see us. So I'll be back there today. Is anybody else here prepared to come sit this man? I know a bunch of us were at the 8 o'clock. Alan is here in the back. I think the rest of us were at 8 o'clock with them. So feel free to stop by and say hello. Thank you.
Please stand.
Hymn is in the Lady Diamond, hymn 38, Calvary.